has been complaining. Sometimes I feel like if I was a child. We want to bring to your attention that the chapel may be just a little bit extended today, so if you do have a class that you need to get to, I'm sure Lute will not be offended. We are also fortunate to hear from the choir, and we will hope to sing a little bit today, too. Let us begin with prayer. Gracious and merciful God, you continue to shower us with blessings. We are blessed by this day, by this school, and by special people in our lives. Today we remember especially those who have given so much so that Augsburg can continue to be a beacon to this community, the church, and to the world. We thank you in particular for the gift of Lute Olson and for the example he has given to millions of people. Give us all lives of purpose and value as we continually seek your intention for this world. In your name we pray. Amen.
Jesus, I offer to the man, is the people, my six, my horse, our body. Stand by occupation and area of service is in the coaching of basketball. He is best known for his work as a head basketball coach at the University of Iowa and now at the University of Arizona. His teams have participated twice in the NCAA Final Four. He has been recognized twice as a National Coach of the Year. I'm pleased to present a graduate and a friend of Augsburg, Mr. Lute Olson. Circumstances of an early marriage, I passed up baseball until my senior season, but had an opportunity to play every year, or at least the 1 year in baseball. When I went out to coach, I think probably my first job, I think back to the experience at Winona, Minnesota. Now that is not starting at the top and working your way down, I'll tell you that for sure. But when I had come on campus at Augsburg for the first time to meet Coach Anderson, I went over to the old gymnasium, I guess, I don't know what you'd call it. It was a barracks that had been made into, they put some baskets up at each end, I guess. And I walked into the locker room, and there was Ernie down on his knees, scrubbing the locker room floor. And Ernie, little did I know how that prepared me for my first high school job, because I went to Winona, Minnesota, had a tremendous salary at that time, $3,200. I coached football as an assistant, the only assistant. I coached the JV team. I coached basketball, and I coached baseball. In addition to that, I taught six classes with four preparations. So your day was relatively busy. But the thing that Ernie really prepared me for was, I'll never forget, the first day of a contest as a coach, you know, something that you look forward to through your whole training and first football game. So that afternoon I went down to the physical education office and to talk with my head football coach, who was also Deborah. There were two of us on the staff. And I said, well, I'm going to go home, grab a bite to eat, and then I'll be back, at the time designated for the coaches to be back. And he said, well, fine. He said, but don't forget about the other part of your job. And I said, what's the other part of my job? And he said, you should have read your contract better. So I hope now in teacher preparation here that contract reading is part of what goes in. I said, what do you mean? He said, you are in charge of lining the football field on game days. Scouts out. That's how we started. So now when I think back on it, with Ernie down there on his knees scrubbing that floor, he was really getting the point across to me. This is a wonderful profession, young man, so get used to doing whatever you have to do, I guess, to fulfill it. But I had 13 years in on the high school level in Minnesota and then in California, 4 years on the junior college level. In California, which I enjoyed very much, I got my master's degree in guidance and counseling and had worked as a coach and counselor. 1 year at Long Beach State University, 9 years at the University of Iowa, and 9 years now at the University of Arizona. I'm not much of a mathematician, but you can see that's a whole lot of years that have gone by since my time here at Augsburg. I've been asked many times by people, why Augsburg? I had an opportunity to go to some larger schools. I had grown up in a small town in North Dakota, 1,800 people. When I moved to Grand Forks, I met a pastor at our church who was an Augsburg graduate. And I guess you'd have to say with Augie, once an Augie, always an Augie. Is that not the case? At least from the people that I've known, that's certainly the case. And from the day I think that I first met him and he had seen me as an athletic performer, he was constantly pushing Augsburg to look at the things that a college should really do for you. And when it got down to my decision to come here, I wanted a college where I felt that I could grow, number one, as a person, then as a student and as an athlete. And I think that's the thing that those of you who are involved in this college will find as you go through your years, as I've gone through mine, that those are the things that come back to you, that your growth here as a person. I always felt in being involved here at Augsburg that there was a very caring attitude. I don't care if it was in a sociology class or a science class, or it was participation in the athletic program, there were people who cared more about you as a person than they did whether you were garnering all the knowledge that you should out of that class or whether you were competing as you should on the basketball court or on the football field. It was a caring relationship from the faculty, and I think that spread and was also a part of the caring relationship that I experienced with the my fellow students while I was here. I've also been asked many times, how did that experience at a smaller college differ from being at a large university? Now, at the University of Arizona, we have 37,000 full-time students. That's a lot of people. It concerns me sometimes because I think 37,000, how can 37,000 people feel like they're a part of something as opposed to being a number in that 37,000. And I think it's a concern. I know with us and raising our children, one high school that they attended in California for a couple of years had 4,800 students. Now, how can you be an individual and how can you have a feeling of self-worth if you are in that larger group? And I think back on the situation here and the caring atmosphere and the family atmosphere that's so prevalent at Augsburg. And I've tried to carry that into my coaching and into my relationship with people. If you were to ask anyone at the University of Iowa during the years that we were there or at the University of Arizona now, how would much to a person that's been involved, they will say it's a family. It's a basketball family. It's a case of where these young people are part of the family, but then the entire community, you try to get involved as a part of that family. Now, this may seem mind-boggling to you, but at the University of Arizona, we have a facility that holds just about 14,000 people. We have, in the last 5 years, never had a public sale of a ticket at the University of Arizona. For 5 consecutive years, there have been 0 tickets available. They are season ticket holders who come back again and again and again. We had 4 tickets come up for sale last year out of 14,000, and they happen to be people who were moving to the Far East. Why is that? Well, obviously good basketball, but you know what? I think it's more than that. I think it's the fact that because this is a family and our players as a family try to get the university and to try to get the community involved as a family. We have a basic saying with our players. There are enough takers in the world. What we need to develop through this program are givers, because those are not quite as easy to find. So if you were to see our players' involvement, and I think a lot of this goes back to the things that that I learned during my experience here. I've been involved in a number of different things, but my involvement is always our involvement. So if I'm, as I've been the vice chairman person of the United Way campaign in Tucson over the last 4 years, where we've raised during that time close to $40 million, the basketball team is involved. Every young man in our program is out participating in United Way. When I get back now, we leave here tomorrow on Thursday night, we have a raffle of basketball items for the Arthritis Center at the University of Arizona. On Saturday, we will have our Scramble Golf Tournament, where every player and every person involved in our program is involved in that golf tournament. Whether they've ever had a club in their hand or not, they participate. The team has raised over the last 5 years somewhat over $500,000 for the Arthritis Center. And we can go through the involvement of the YMCA, we can go through the involvement in the Heart Association and the Cancer Society or whatever in the community, and they're involved. And I get this put to me so many times. It's amazing how much the players get involved as opposed to most Division I basketball programs. And I have to mention to you that this team, through the last 5-6 years, has never been out of the top 20 teams in the country. And yet I think the thing that breaks this team and this program apart from a lot of programs is they care about the community, they care about people, and that to me is so much a part of the experience that each of you as students and each of you who came through this institution have learned from the involvement here. So it's a case of where the ideas and the thoughts and the feelings that were expressed to me here as a student athlete have carried over into my experience as a Division I basketball coach. We have a basic attitude with our players that we are going to play together. We're going to play hard, because I think work ethic is something that's very vital to the development of an individual, and we're going to be the best that we can be. Now, at least we're going to strive for that goal. The attitudes that I learned here, I've done a little videotape that will be shown tonight where I had an opportunity to just develop a little bit some of my thoughts about what does Augsburg mean to you. Well, I see G-Roy out here, classroom, that the relationship between the students and the teacher was not like, here's the teacher up here and the students are down here and the teacher is looking down. I mean, here was a case where you could feel the kind of love and concern that should be present, I think, in education between the instructor and the students. And there's so many experiences like that I'm not going to bore you with all of them. But I do want to get the point across to you. As students here, I would suggest that as you continue through your college experience, remember the development as a person will far exceed the things that you may be learning right now in the classroom. I'm not saying that knowledge is not an important thing, but we're in a changing world. The things that seem to be important from a technical standpoint right now, 10 years from now, are not going to be the important thing. So if that's the case in this changing world, then you better make sure that the skills that you develop as a person here is the full development of yourself as an individual, a person who can communicate and give to people rather than looking for what you can gain from it yourself individually. I certainly enjoyed having a chance to come back and say hello. I'm looking forward to the opportunity tonight at the dinner. I'm happy to be able to be in a position where my wife and I can be involved in trying to give at least a little bit back to a place that's been very, very special to me. Thank you.
So we're going to sing the first and last stanzas of Amazing Grace 448.